I'm going to talk about Nash equilibria. So Nash equilibria is a concept that was studied by Nash and has become famous and was studied a lot by economists, political science, in biology, and now in computer science, of course. So I will try to first motivate the study of Nash equilibria for computer scientists by giving you a small example that you can relate to. So in this room, we have an antenna, which is over there. And there are some laptops that are open and that are communicating with this antenna wirelessly. So now you have to imagine that you can control the power you are using to emit to this antenna. So in the beginning, I've drawn on this graphic. So here is the bandwidth you get if everyone is using about the same power. Now imagine when one of you want to upload some file and needs more bandwidth. What you can do is increase the power it's using, so that here you see that the power I've raised, and its bandwidth also raised, but it decreases the bandwidth of others because of interferences. So of course, the other users that are connected to the same antenna are not happy. What they can do is react, but doing the same thing that the red laptop just did. And then you see the bandwidth is roughly the same than in the beginning, but they are all using more power. So that's bad because your battery is going down. And so the situation is worse than in the beginning. So that's one thing we would like to avoid. So we want to find some way to control the power everybody is using so that everybody is happy and the situation is something you want to keep and not deviate from the initial situation like the red laptop did. So I want to draw the global pictures of how we want to deal with this problem. So you have the problem I presented. So that's an example of some problem with multiple agents that have different objectives. So I'm going to specify this problem in some formal language to describe an arena. I don't know if you see, but it's some model, a graph, a game on graph, like a concurrent game or a time game, that will be the models I will talk about. So then you want an algorithm to give you good solutions. So good solutions for us will be Nash equilibria. You don't have unicity of Nash equilibria in a game, so that's why I have here five different solutions that are really different, because you have, in reality, an infinite number of solutions in this particular game, but there are only five that are really different in that the final state in which it stabilizes is different. So then I'm going to choose one of these solutions. The one on the right is better because it chooses less power for everybody. And I want my tool to give me the full strategy that implements this equilibria. And then I can implement really in the devices the strategy. So that's what we would like to have. And of course, the really challenging part is the part when you go from the game to the solution. And that's what I'm going to talk about. So first, our model. In the beginning, we were interested in time games. So It's nice to model a real-time system. So in this model, so you have states, you have clocks. You can reset the clocks and compare them to some constants. So for instance, y is greater than 3. So it's not a timed automata, it's a time game. You see that transitions are either red or blue. So transitions are controlled by players. So the red transitions are controlled by the red player, and the blue transition by the blue player. And you can have as many players as you want. Here I only have two. The way it's played is you put a token in the initial state. Then both players choose a delay and a transition that are the color, their color. So for instance, the red player choose a delay of 1.5 and the transition that's going down. And the blue player choose a delay of 2 and the transition that is going to the right. Among all these actions that were given by the player, you take the one with the smallest delay. So here it's 1.5, so you take the red transition to the left and you move the token, you update the clocks, and then you continue the game and it will give you an infinite play. So if you know about time automata, you know about the region construction, and using the same thing, you can translate the time games into a concurrent game that is finite. So I'm not going to detail this construction, but you have to know that instead of suggesting a delay, you select an interval, so which corresponds to a region. So this game is finite. It's a finite concurrent game because players are choosing actions in parallel, so at the same time. But one thing there is about this concurrent game, it's that it's non-deterministic, and I'm going to talk a bit more about that later. So what is a concurrent game formally? So you have states. So here, in fact, I'm trying to model the game I talked about in the beginning about power control. So here the states represent the power each player is using. So 0-0 means they both use no power at all. 0-1 means the second player is using a bit of power, and 2 a bit more. So in this example, I have still only 2 players, but you can have many more. The action in this game is to raise the power you're using or stick at the same. We have a function that describes the actions that are allowed for each player. So if you are not at the maximum, you can either raise or stay at the same. And if you are at the maximum, you can only stay at the same power, so 2. You have a transition table that describes from a state and an action for each player, which is the next state. And then your strategies depends on the sequence of states that you have seen so far. So in particular, here we want to them to depend only on the states and not on the action of each player. So in some sense, they are invisible. So this is particularly important if you want to model time games, because they both choose in parallel their delay, and you select the action that was first. But if you want to imagine that in real life, you don't have any way to know what was the delay that was chosen to the player that has the largest one. You only see the action of the smallest delay. So in some sense, the action of the other players are invisible. You only see the outcome of the action that was selected with the smallest. So we have some restrictions on the problem. So we only look at pure strategies. We don't have any stochastic vertices. And we have perfect information on the states. So everybody is observing the states with full information. And if we try to remove one of these three conditions, the general problem of Nash equilibria will become indecidable. So that's why we are sticking to that for now. So the concept of Nash equilibria I already talked about. So formally, it's a strategy profile. So you give each player a strategy, such that there is not one player alone that can change the outcome by changing his strategy, such that it profits her. So you can see it formally. So you have a strategy profile such that for all player, if she chooses to change her strategy, her outcome is not better for her than the outcome of the strategy profile that defines the Nash equilibria. So I said the concurrent game we are going to look at are non-deterministic. So the problem is that you can have several outcomes for the same strategy profile. So we had to define another concept that is pseudo-Nash equilibria. So it's not so different. It's just that when you deviate, you can also choose the outcome that you prefer. So now I'm going to talk about the decision problem we have. So we have three different decision problems. Of course, the simplest one is existence. Does there exist in the game a Nash equilibria? So it's not always the case because we don't have mixed strategies, only pure strategies. We also have constraint existence and verification problems. So the verification, you give a payoff for each player. So you say which player are winning and which ones are losing. And you want to know if there is a Nash equilibrium with that particular payoff. In the constraint existence, you say some players are losing, some players are winning, and the others, I don't care. So that's three different decision problems, but we will see that in general they have the same complexity. Now, the objectives we are going to look at for now are the very simple one. So reachability, safety, and Buchi objectives. So for the reachability objective, each player is trying to reach some states. For safety, the players are going to try to avoid some states. And for Buchi, you are trying to see infinitely often some states. Now I'm going to try to characterize Nash equilibria so that we are going to have an algorithm to decide the three problems. So in Nash equilibria, you have to ensure that nobody by deviating can improve its payoff. So if you have a reachability objective, for instance, you have to ensure that in a state that is controlled by one player, she cannot deviate and visit its winning state. So in turn-based game, that's easy. So you just compute the attractor and check that the path of your outcome does not visit this attractor. But it's not so simple in concurrent games. Also, when you have non-determinism, and of course in time games, because states are not controlled by one player. So you see that, for instance, if you have two players that are playing some matching penny game, if the path was going up, they can both change their action so that the path is going down. So you cannot reuse the notion of attractor here. So it's the same in time games. If they change a bit the delay, so the one that was the longest make it shorter than the first one, or the other way around, it's the same thing. You cannot know which one is deviating. So if you have two players that could have deviated from the path, you have to ensure that they both don't visit their winning state. So it requires that you are able to know who is deviating, or to know all the players that are going to be able to deviate. So in the previous case, it was simple. If there is only one, in the turn-based case, it was simple. If you have only one, you have to blame him and ensure he's losing. But if both players can deviate, you have to ensure that both of them are punished. So this leads to the notion of suspects. So suspects are the player that might be deviating along your path. So in the beginning, everyone is a potential deviator. So the suspects is everybody. But then, as you choose a path, you will be able to know a bit more about who are suspects and can be deviating. Since in Nash Equilibria, you know that only one player at a time can deviate. So if you have given an action profile, so an action for each player, and the path is going the way you predicted it, all players are suspects because they are potential deviators. They will be able to deviate later in the game. In turn-based game, you know that if we have deviated to another state, only the player that was controlling the state you were coming from can change his action to go to the other state. So that's the one you are going to blame. So as I said earlier, you have to compute the attractor and check that this state is not inside it. Now, in non-deterministic games, I said anybody can choose the outcome that is best for him. So when you have a transition that can be going to any state, you have to consider that all the players are suspects. In time games, so here I put an example. If you have transition controlled by a green player and transition controlled by the red player, then they can both change their delay, and so there are two suspects for the deviation that is going to the red state. So now we want to characterize equilibria. So we define a repeller transition system. So that's the states and the transition from which you are sure you can punish anyone that is deviating on its own. So you can write it formally like that. If somebody deviates, then you are sure that its outcome is not winning. So its computation is quite similar to an attractor computation, except that you have to keep track of who is suspect. So as I said, you can have several players that are suspect, and you have to ensure that none of them reach their objective. So none of them can win. And we have, so the characterization of Nash Equilibria is that we have a path where the players in some set P lose if we have an infinite path in this three-player transition system that visits infinitely often the state of the player that are winning. So now we want an algorithm to decide that. So it's for Buchi objectives, and an efficient one. So in Buchi, I'm going to give an example. So the color are not nice, that's okay. In Buchi games, you know that the outcome of your strategy profile is going to end up in some strongly connected components of the game. So what you do is that, I don't know if you can see it clearly, but in this game you have two strongly connected components. You know, you look at which player are losing if you loop through all the states of the strongly connected component. You compute the repeller transition system. So you maybe that eliminates some states, so you remove them. And then the strongly connected components are not the same. So you have to do that again. And in the end, if there is a correspondence between your hyperbolic transition system and the strongly connected component you find, you will know you have a Nash equilibrium that ends in that strongly connected component. And this, because of this, the algorithm can work in polynomial time. So by computing the strongly connected component and looking at the players that we can enforce or losing. So we have a polynomial time algorithm for Buchi conditions. Now we want to extend this result a bit. So we define some notion of game simulation that I can illustrate on some example. So you have two games that are different. So in the first game, player A1 and A2 choose some number between 0 and 1, and that gives us some outcome, so either green, red, blue, or orange. So it's an infinite game because the number of actions of each player is infinite. And this one is a finite game, so each player has four different actions. And if you take an action profile in this game, you can make it correspond to an action profile in that game. You look at the possible outcome where blue is suspect, the particular outcome where red is suspect. So for blue, you have green, blue, and red. And you can see that the blue is suspect for the same region in the other game. So in fact, this game simulates each other. And we have a property that if there is a Nash equilibrium in one of them, there is a Nash equilibrium in the other one. So we use this to show that in time games, we can use the region construction, the region game we have shown, and it's explained completely because the number of regions is exponential. One other thing we wanted to do is specify objectives with Buchi automata. So we can do the product with the game and show that they simulate each other. And we also have an exponential time result. So it's both in X time and X time complete, and we showed that by encoding countdown games. When the automata describing the objective of each player are 1 week, we show a particular result that we can stick to use only a polynomial space. In deterministic games, we also have some nice results that says that to compute the repeater transition system, we only need polynomial time because the transition table can be big. So that's the summary of the result. So we have Buchi, which is the simplest condition for our problem. For deterministic safety, we have and reachability, we have an NP algorithm. And I've talked about the more general case of Buchi automata and time games. So to conclude, we have an implementation of the polynomial time algorithm, and we can also solve a safety and reachability game. We would like to extend this result to other objectives by giving a general way to adapt algorithm for computing winning region to compute Nash equilibria. We also would like to look at games in different models. So for instance, push-down games. For imperfect information and randomized strategies, I've said that the problem is undecidable, but maybe with some restrictions like finite memory, you can have a decidability result. And we might also look at other equilibria notions, such as secure equilibria. And I've reached the end of my talk, so thank you for your attention.